Good evening, everyone. Time for another member update. This is the chart of the euro US dollar. You can see this morning we had a kind of a head fake that happened. This was related to an FT article, and it was actually a false report. They give a false report about the ECB's decision, and there was a sell-off in the euro. Of course, that took out all the stops. That article is retracted, and the opposite was posted. So that's very interesting. But you can see the gigantic move that happened in the euro when they didn't cut rates. Well, they can't cut rates because they're zero, but they didn't go further into negative rates as the market expected. And so it's craziness. It's all central bankers and central planners trying to manipulate things, and of course things are crumbling as we speak, and the central planners are trying to control things, at least to have a controlled demolition. Now what's interesting is that we had a move in silver, not a big move, but a volume move in silver that actually occurred at the same time. You can see the volume that came into silver, paper silver, and we had that interesting touchdown of 1382. Now I think that we're probably going to see some new lows, and the reason why I say that is because the U.S. Mint is prepared to suspend Silver Eagle sales December 11th and do their retooling that they have to do. And so in the past we have seen that we get the low prices. We had this last year when the Eagles are not traded. We got a big spike low, and then of course when they came back the price was higher. What that amounts to is the inability, here's another one from the year before, the inability of anyone to buy them because they're simply not available. So the lowest prices are when silver is not available. But we want to talk about this Hunnable announcement and how that's connected to manipulation of the silver price. Something may be going on when we look at this volume that happened to coincide with this Hunnable announcement. And we're going to play a video and look at the history of this. I was not aware of it till I looked into it. But before we do that, I want to talk about this Puerto Rico crisis. Now, this has all of the markings of the shady dealings that these central planners do behind closed doors. Nothing is a coincidence. Nothing is an accident. All the things they do are planned out ahead of time, and they have various schemes, and then they have ways of manipulating public opinion to make those schemes happen. So I'm going to start off with testimony. This was the December 1st Senate Judiciary Committee meeting on the solvency issues with Puerto Rico and the question that's now being brought up as to whether or not Puerto Rico should be given access to Chapter 9 bankruptcy. Now, just as an aside here, and let me point out a few things. First of all, when the bonds were issued originally in Puerto Rico, it was specifically stated that the bankruptcy was not an available option. That's one of the reasons why the rates were what they were, and why the ratings of those bonds were what they were. Now they're talking about changing the rules mid-game, and that's a typical scenario. But this hearing is the Senate trying to decide what they're going to do, and as I'm going to show you with the stories that have come out today, they have already made up their minds about what they're going to do. We had some very interesting testimony. I watched the whole thing. There's a representative of the bondholders who's very passionate and eloquent. There's also a gentleman who is an economist from Puerto Rico who is stating the facts here. And this is his a section of his testimony. He talked a number of times, but this is where he's beginning to recognize that this whole thing is already a done deal and they are not interested in the facts. And of course the facts are, let me point out that the Christmas bonuses for Puerto Rican government employees are set to be paid this year. I believe they've announced a 10% bonus. So they're paying Christmas bonuses as they're going bankrupt. This is typical. This is something that we see with corrupt governments. They milk it and steal until the very end. And then, of course, they try to stick the taxpayers with the bill. So let's listen to this professor with his exasperated plea for them to actually look at the facts, but they're not interested in facts.
There was a comment made about something I said earlier I wanted to clarify.
Please, go ahead.
Senator, you pointed to the Moody's report, which I have right here with me. As I mentioned earlier in my testimony, footnote 3 of that document, the reference that they use is a working group report. And I explained to you how that working group report is based on selective information at best. Now, I'm a professor of finance. I prefer to live in academia, not in politics. And the reason I do that is because in academia, I have a better shot at with the evidence. In politics, it's not as such. I was talking to a friend last night, and I was saying, you know, my challenge tomorrow at the hearing, I have the facts. They're not my facts. They are official documents, audited statements, the ones available, official numbers from the planning board. And I know what the facts say. But you don't know me. Ann Krieger is a respected person in economics. Moody's is a respected person in economics. I assure you, in my corporate finance PhD class, we examine the scientific evidence, and part of that evidence talks about how analysts in financial markets don't stand a chance in terms of how they perform in analysis. But again, you are bound to trust Moody's, I understand. The scientific evidence questions their judgment, but the facts are not what they are saying they are.
Thank you. I just have we're trying to finish by around noon to be respectful of your time as well. We really appreciate your time today. I know Senator.
And so we really appreciate your time. If you have a chance, watch the entire hearing. But basically, he's admitting that they really don't care about the facts. They care about the politics. And it's a fascinating hearing. I usually don't delve into that type of stuff. But let's look at the news that broke today. And you can see that they really have already decided what they're going to do. Let's start out with this story. This one just broke. Puerto Rico fundraiser officials indicted on corruption charges. Now, the professor who was just arguing basically was in agreement with the bond analyst who came from, who's a representative of the bondholders who were going to get stiffed in this deal, said that no, they have the ability to make these payments. They just need to cut their spending. They need to trim these huge government salaries and government bonuses. And of course, the professor's argument was, no, we need to spend the money in infrastructure. They've been spending on government operations. But now we see today, this is December 3rd, 2:22 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we've got Puerto Rican officials indicted on corruption charges. The U.S. Federal Bureau of Investigation has charged 10 Puerto Rican officials and businessmen, including a leading fundraiser for the governing party, with corruption, extortion, bribery, and wire fraud. Puerto Rico's U.S. Attorney Rosa Emilia Rodriguez-Velez said Thursday in a statement that the 25-count indictment exposes the underhanded dealings and cronyism within the island's cash-strapped government. So that's very important. You have to remember what the professor and what the bond representative was arguing against is a control board. This is their way of saying, no, we're not going to allow the free market to decide things. We're going to put a control board in charge here. And that's what the Wall Street cronies had argued for. Now, here's another story. This is one that just broke today at around noon. You can see U.S. High Court set to act on Puerto Rico restructuring bid. The U.S. Supreme Court may announce as soon as Friday whether it will hear an appeal by Puerto Rico to reinstate a law that would allow some island agencies to restructure their debt. So now they want the Supreme Court to change things. This harkens back to, remember the GM bondholders, if you're a bondholder and you have your bonds based on the interest rate, that's why you bought them, guess what? They can change the rules. The High Court is scheduled to review Puerto Rico's appeal during a private conference Friday when it often issues a list of new cases. The disputed law would affect $22 billion of Puerto Rico's $70 billion in debt. I don't have time to go through the whole story. And, of course, we know that there was a payment due December 1st, and Puerto Rico actually made that payment, or did they make that payment? It's kind of up in the air as to whether that occurred, but they made this $354 million debt payment, and that's very near the time those hearings were going on. And this is from Amy Stone. One of the questions municipal bond investors are asking this week is just how Puerto Rico's Government Development Bank managed to make a $354 million debt payment on Tuesday. The answer, it wasn't pretty. The payment involved a kind of budgetary musical chairs that can't be repeated many more times. In a Thursday commentary titled "The Clawback Cometh," Cumberland Advisors explains that the cash wasn't on the Commonwealth's balance sheet. Instead, it was pulled from revenues collected by other public entities. Quote, the payment comes at a time when the island lacks a governing regulatory structure for how to repay its debts. The sloshing around of funds among entities signifies this need. Island officials have stated that the Commonwealth has begun clawing back monies from highways, the convention center, the IFA, and the Metro. In doing so, they have, in the words of the governor, begun to default on our debt. This is all very bad news for holders of the debt of the public entities, which is now taking a backseat to guaranteed debt, but it's not a great sign for the sustainability of future general obligation bond payments either. On January 1st, Puerto Rico owes a cool $1 billion in debt payments. Standard & Poor's Rating Services said in a December 3rd report that is plenty worried. Analysts write, we believe that even if Puerto Rico prioritizes its $331 million GO interest payment due on January 1st, 2016 at the expense of other bondholders, this diversion of revenue pledged to other bonds would merely postpone an eventual GO debt default, because GO debt service payments due July 1st, 2016 and afterwards remain at risk due to likely continued deterioration in the Commonwealth's cash position over time. So you can see this hearing that we had here on Puerto Rico, this is kind of like just a show. It's already a done deal. They've already decided, in my opinion, to appoint a control board, to involve the U.S. Congress, to involve the Supreme Court. And ultimately, we're going to find that the U.S. taxpayer is going to be on the hook for bailing out Puerto Rico. So let's go to the main story of the night. Now, this is going to be the story about Hunnibal and her resignation. Hunnibal is the CME Group's precious metals director, actually metals director. You can see here's the headline, December 2nd. Hunnibal to leave CME Group on December 11th. She joined the company in 2011 from Macquarie. December 2nd, CME Group Inc. Executive Director for Metals Products, Harriet Hunnibal, will leave the company later this month, a CME spokesman said on Wednesday. Hunnibal, who has been with the futures market operator CME Group since early 2011. Keep that date in mind, early 2011. What was that? 2011 was the year when we had the run-up from a near doubling of silver prices into May with the CME's coordinated smackdown. was responsible for developing the company's precious metals portfolio. The group's U.S. gold futures contracts are the most liquid in the world. Quote, she resigned and leaves the 11th of December. The spokesman said, declined to give further details. Hunnable was not immediately available to comment. Hunnable joined the CME from Macquarie Bank, having previously worked for UBS, Merrill Lynch, and N.M. Rothschild. She was tipped in 2013 as a potential candidate for the role of head of the London Metals Exchange, the world's biggest marketplace for aluminum, copper, link, zed, tin, lead, zinc, tin, and nickel. At the time, she downplayed her interest in the post, saying she was enjoying her role at the CME Group. Hunnable's time at the CME has coincided with a period of flux for the London precious metals market. CME, in association with Thomson Reuters, CME and Thomson Reuters took over last year as operator of the London benchmark silver price after a regulatory drive for transparency brought the 117-year-old silver fix, which it replaced, to an end. The precious metals markets are likely to see further changes next year. The London Bullion Market Association, the LBMA, said last month that a number of exchanges, brokers, and data vendors had expressed an interest in providing clearing or reporting services to make the gold market more liquid and transparent. So there's the story. Now, I want to take you back to an interview with Hunnable. And apparently, she was the one who presided over those surprise CME margin hikes. And this is interesting. This is Bloomberg, and the Bloomberg reporters actually putting her on the spot here. Let's watch this.
We continue now with our series on heavy metals. The CME Group increased margin requirements 5 times in a 2-week period. And silver reacted. After reaching an all-time high in April, it tumbled more than 30%, the biggest drop in such a time period in 30 years. Earlier, I spoke with Harriet Hunnable, CME's managing director for metals, and asked her why.
Well, you know, the markets have become very volatile. We've seen a real increase in market volatility and also in implied option volatility. And that's been the major determinant in changing our margin requirements for the exchange.
Although as a result of your boosting the margin requirements for silver, you drove the price down. I think the most that it's been driven down in 5 trading days in 30 years, a 30% decline
in silver.
You
know,
from an outside onlooker, it could seem as if you're trying to drive the price of silver down.
Well, you know what? You had a great show yesterday with Jeff Christian from CPM, and he told you there that those allegations are really off the mark. It's important that traders, investors, everybody involved in the market knows that when they trade on an exchange, there's sufficient margin to back up those trades. And in highly volatile markets, margins may be increased to try and ensure that the market works really efficiently, and that's simply what we did. And do you know what? Since the beginning of 2009, we've actually changed our silver margins up and down 23 times because volatility changes that much.
So can investors expect then when the volatility is taken out of the silver market, you will reduce margin requirements again?
Absolutely. Every day we look at the market, we look at volatility, we do the same calculations. Prices up or down, if volatility falls significantly, we will look to reduce our margin requirement, we'll signal that to the market, and we'll give the market a day's notice before we change the market requirements.
Of course, we know that they didn't give any notice. In fact, we know that they raised margin requirements 5 times in a row in 2011 on a holiday weekend. And so that gives lie to it. So for those of you who can do analysis about the blinking of eyes and lying, that's the silver honey, and that's her explanation. She's gone now. And what does that signal? Well, it may signal something when we look at the volume that's come in to silver. It's not insignificant. You can see here that this spike right here, this is today, and it rivals anything we've had in the past. An enormous volume in buying on silver. What does it mean? I'm not really sure. What is Hunnable's leaving the CME group mean? I don't know. What does it mean that they're taking over Puerto Rico and they're going to put them in receivership and probably use tax money to bail them out? It just means that the central planners, they are trying to keep this house of cards, this stage show with plates spinning. They're trying to keep all the plates spinning, all the balls in the air. But very, very soon, the whole thing is going to come crashing down. And we'll talk to you next time.